our guest, Thompson. I see that the session is called Fashioning a Creative and Emotional Writing Environment on the topic of script editing. I'm going to introduce Pete briefly, and then I'm going to hand over to him and ask him to give us perhaps a more detailed introduction to himself. And because we're hoping this conversation will go today, we want it to be a conversation in the room, so at any stage, please feel free to contribute. What we're heading towards is for Pete to talk about, in essence, the philosophy he brings to the process of working with writers. I just want to quote something, Keith, that you said, which is in our little booklet. Pete says, "My working method is to have long and intimate conversations with the writer, and I'd like to share the substance of some of those conversations during this session with a view to articulating, if only to myself, something of my development philosophy." So that's what we're hoping to achieve here today. Briefly, Keith has an extraordinary track record in Australia as a screenwriter, as a script editor, and as a teacher and mentor. He has a 10-time, I have to look at the paper because I haven't got it all in my head because you've done so much. He's a 10-time winner of the Albee Awards, which is the Australian Writers Guild Awards. They give out prizes for stage, film, television, and radio. And Keith has also 3 times won the Supreme Award, which is the top award that the Australian Writers Guild give out, most recently for his feature film adaptation of The Sapphires, which some of you may have been lucky enough to see at the film festival recently, which I can't wait to see when it opens here commercially, which he co-wrote with writer Tony Briggs. He's script edited over 25 feature films, and when I look through the history of the people that you've worked with, a lot of them are newer writers, a lot of them first feature writers, so I think that will be a very advantageous area for us to hear from you about, Keith. Also, as a teacher, he at that stage was head of writing at Afters, and he's held many, many and varied positions across the spectrum in Australian television and film. So without further ado, Keith, I wonder if perhaps you could give us a more lengthy introduction or going over your history to give us a sense of how you've arrived at your current philosophy.
Okay, that's if I have one. You know, when you put your CV together like that, it always sounds like there's a kind of critical path that led you to this moment, and I'm not sure that that's always the case. But anyway, yeah, just a bit about who I am. Oh, thank you for having me. My first trip to New Zealand. So I've been writing professionally in Australia since 1974. I don't always say how long I've been writing to you. People know that you feel you never work again, you know. Anyway, I've been doing it for about almost 40 years. I've written lots and lots of Australian TV, maybe about 100 hours of that, across the spectrum. I started it in Australia working for Crawford Productions, who were churning out police dramas. I did that for about 6 years. That was where I kind of learned my craft. I was head of writing at the Australian Film School at Afters for a couple of years, from about 1980 to 1982. I think your success there is almost dependent on the students you have, and I feel I was really lucky. I had P.J. Hogan was a precocious 17-year-old. He was one of my students. Joss Morehouse, who he met there and later married, she was one of my students. Gerard Lee, who co-wrote Sweetie with Jane Campion and has just written Top of the Lake with Jane. Deb Roswell, Ian David, names you may or may not know. That actually was the start of my script editing kind of career, I suppose, because as head of writing, what I actually did was edit the student scripts as they were going through and working in a consultancy way with them. And when I left there, I continued my own writing career, but the kind of script editing kind of things sort of took off from there as well. I was deputy commissioning editor for drama at ABC TV with Sue Masters. Sue Masters was the the head of drama. I did that for a couple of years. I wasn't very good at it, I don't think. I couldn't say no to anyone. If someone comes through the door with an idea, you just think, oh, well, bless them. And so I soon had to be the bad cop. I've been script editor now on about 25 movies, I think. Samson and Delilah was one, Warwick Thornton's movie, Love Serenade, Japanese Story, The Waiting City, La Spaniola, there's a lot of them. Interestingly enough, I don't think I ever set out to be a script editor. It was just one thing led to another. I've never advertised, you know, I've never said, you know, put my phone number in the directory. It just seems to unfold that people sort of, you know, I work with someone, you know, they talk to someone else, and that's the way it happens. In terms of my own writing, I've now written two feature films. I wrote a feature film called Clubland, which I'm not sure was ever shown in New Zealand. It had Brenda Blethyn, the English actress, was in it. That was screened at Sundance in 2007 and was bought by Warner Brothers Independent and had a significant American release. The American distributors couldn't work out whether it was a comedy or a drama, so they changed the name so that it would sound funnier. And called it Introducing the Dwights, and then it didn't do and I've co-written the Sapphires. That was a 6-year journey, I think, with Tony Briggs. Tony Briggs, you may know, it's the story of, based on a true story, it's the true story of four Aboriginal girls who went to Vietnam during the course of the war to entertain the American troops. And Tony's mum, Laurel, was one of those women that went as a 21-year-old. So he's grown up with the story. He wrote it as a stage play initially. I'd known Tony even before he wrote the stage play, and you know, a film that I'm fortunate enough to have got involved in the adaptation. We worked on that together for 6 years. It was shown at Cannes this year in May, and got, you know, for us it was an extraordinary reaction. We had 10-minute standing up clapping thing, which was great. And Harvey Weinstein, the Weinstein company, has bought it for American release. So this little story of four Indigenous girls in country Victoria going to Vietnam will now be shown all over the world. And beautifully and thankfully, audiences in Australia have kind of embraced it. It opened 3 weeks ago, and the last figures I saw were that it's the box office so far is 8.4 million, which is just extraordinary. So that's me. That's where I came from. As I said, the script editing journey wasn't something I planned, but it's something I really enjoy doing. In the kind of broader spectrum of my writing career, I feel that it's enabled me to concentrate on my feature writing work, because rather than writing too much television, I've chosen to take script editing jobs because, you know, if you write a lot of television, there's nothing wrong in writing television, but, you know, there's hours of it. But all the time you're writing television, you can't actually be doing your own writing, whereas with script editing, it's a lovely complement to what I'm doing. So that's the kind of balance I've tried to keep. And you know, as Christina said, I've tended to work with newer writers, and I think that's just because the people I started working with came from film school and they were newer talents. But I've also enjoyed working with newer people as well. So that's part of the profile of
what I wonder, picking up on that, yeah. One of the things you said very strongly is that script editing is as much about editing the writer as it is about editing the script,
yeah.
And particularly with newer writers, I think.
Yeah.
So I wonder if you could talk a little bit about what you mean by that.
Yeah, look, there's an awful lot of advice about script editing and how to write screenplays. You know, there are any number of books. There's Robert McKee and Sid Field and all of those people. And I think I've done, you know, Robert McKee's story. Has he? He's been here, presumably. Yeah. I've done that course, and I think it's an incredible course, you know. But I think it's of most value when you've actually written something. I think that it's kind of a tool of analysis. It's something when you've actually got the thing written that you can look back and you can put the template and you can say, do I have an exciting incident? Do I have all of that? So I'm not for a moment being dismissive of all of those tools and books and how to write manuals that are there. But as I say, I think they're of most value when you've actually written something. And with newer writers, you find, and this is true for me as a writer, I mean, my script editing method really is only an extension of the way I try and develop and write for myself. That's all I know how to do. And when you start a script, you know, no movie ever falls fully formed, fully structured. You know, you don't have a dream, wake up and write it down. It never works that way. What you start with often is a fragment of an idea or a sense of a character or a sense of a character interaction or any little fragment, or it might be a visual motif, anything like that is your starting point. And somehow that has to go on a journey and become the structure, you know, the form of a movie. And as I say, these How to Write books, I think, can be a bit intimidating when you're a newer writer at that stage, because it kind of presumes that you know how the story is going to unfold and what the story is and all of those things. So my method for myself when I'm writing feature films is, given that I start with that really relatively small fragment of an idea, I like to write a treatment, a very, very broad, sometimes 50 pages of treatment. And it's not a technical document, it's a kind of aspirational document in a sense of what I hope the project could be, what the influences are, because I think you only write by writing, if you know what I mean. Mm. You know, the only way of actually creating something is actually to sit there and write, and that's when the ideas come. So I do this very broad, very loose original document. It's probably not even a treatment. It's more like a letter or a conversation with myself as to where the project could go, what I would like it to be tonally, what it might be, you know. And as lines of dialogue occur to me, I put those in somewhere. And across that 50-page process, I try to, you know, give the thing some shape and give it a form. But it's important for me first to think about themes and to think about, to ask the question, what is this thing about and why am I writing it? You know, why am I writing it?
So is that a question as a script editor that you are asking or wanting to find out from the writer?
And that's the process. I suppose what I do, that conversation that I have with myself, I don't demand the people I'm editing with write a treatment. I turn that process into three or four very long conversations about what they think the project is about. Because there is a reason why you want to write a particular story, and you don't always know what that reason is. And it's really useful to have this kind of counselling session. I mean, there's an element of script editing that is like counselling, and some of the rules of counselling very much apply to script editing, you know, you say to the writer, you've made the important choice, you've come to see me. We're going to talk and I'm going to give you a few tasks, you know, but we'll just go where this thing goes. Because, I mean, people often say that you write a script to answer some question, some unanswered question in your own personality, you know, and that you return to themes because there's some question that you're trying to resolve in your kind of personal life. I mean,
so do you subscribe to that theory?
Look, I do in part. I mean, I think Clubland was an examination of why I said no to so many sexual opportunities. A character who said no a lot. I've worked with an American script consultant, and her theory was that you write as an expression of your personal psychodramatic pain. And she wanted to... I was editing, that's right. I was editing this guy who I hadn't actually met. We'd arranged that I would be the editor. He was on one of those kind of courses where you have consultants. And this was our first meeting. And we sat in the room with the American consultant. I'm not being facetious, but I am really. And she explained to this guy that I'd never met before that we needed to get to the bottom of his, you know, psychological pain. Yeah, and this was our first meeting. We said, well, I don't think I've got him. and she wouldn't have that. What was the most painful thing in your life? And he said, well, I went to boarding school and she left on that. Well, that was separation anxiety, and, you know, there we go. I don't believe it to that degree. I mean, I don't think script editing is psychodrama. But there's a little bit that's an element of that, because I think what you're trying to do is have the conversation with the writer so that they come to understand why they are writing that story, because that's the conversation you have with yourself when you're writing anything. And you don't always know. You don't know why you're drawn to a particular story. You don't know what compels you to write a particular story. But there is usually a reason. And once you can get a bit of a lasso around what this thing is about, other than fragments, then I find that to be a kind of a really empowering process. So that part of the process is conversations about anything and everything, about me finding out what the writer is and, you know, why, getting them to have a conversation with the material so that they can move towards a more complete understanding of why they're doing it. Because I find that once you can sort of, after, you know, those conversations, if you can sort of put things in a bit of a nutshell, that's something you can cling to, because the process of writing has so many vagaries and it goes all over the place. But if you just have this thing that you can cling to as, this is why I'm writing the story, this is what I think it's about, that conclusion will inevitably change through the writing process as the movie becomes, as the script becomes about something else. But there's something really solid about having had the discussion and having the insights to say, this is why this story is appealing to me and this is why I want to write it. We don't do any writing in those first, it's probably the only rule I've got, but in those original sessions we don't do any writing, because as soon as you write something you've invested in the labour that has produced it, and it might not be the right things. So, and love, talk is cheap, you know. People talk for 9 or 10 hours. Nothing is invested in that, but you're moving towards a definition of what the core of the movie is about, and you're starting that process of shaping the story.
So as you move further on in the process,
yeah,
after those initial discussions,
yeah,
once the writer has started to, as you say, invest in terms of putting something on the page,
yes,
can you talk to us a little bit about what the process of the conversation then becomes? What, you know, as you move on through...
Yeah.
What those conversations might evolve around.
I think then it becomes a sense of shaping the story. But, you know, story is almost a kind of cultural context as well. I mean, all of those, you know, how to write that million-dollar movie book, sort of put story as the primary driver of the piece, you know, and probably he calls it story. And sometimes I think, certainly in England, I mean, it sounds like I'm getting stuck into American kind of film culture, and I'm not at all because I love it. But you know, the American dream is about a journey through a landscape, you know, a successful journey through the landscape. The wagon trains went across the West, negotiated the Rockies, and there was El Dorado, California, at the other end. And there's that sense in American society that there is movement through American society, there's always the possibility of movement through the American society, and anyone can be president, you know, kid has that promise that they could be president one day. You know, I grew up in England where if you go 80 miles in any direction, you fall into the sea. You know, there isn't that sense of a journey through the landscape. There's no Greyhound bus waiting that's going to take you to a new life. You know, it's just more of the same. And in a class conscious kind of society where, you know, who you are is defined by class and that sense of movement through a society. And so I know for a fact that I'm more at home with character than I am with story, because story is something that I kind of wrestle with. I don't feel like that I'm, and I don't think lots of writers are, we're not natural born storytellers. We couldn't get a job in a Persian market 2,000 years ago by just, you know, the quality of our story. You know, we just have nice insights into character. And so that character thing is probably more the way I work than story, because my hope, feeling insecure about my actual ability to, you know, structure perfect stories, is that if you have a strong enough relationship with your characters, those characters will shape their story for you. So the next level of conversation for me is usually about character and the character journey. That when I'm working, you know, I don't always come in at the very kind of birth of an idea. Often I'm working with people that have written a draft or two or many more drafts. And so with them, for me, my way through the script is to look at the character journeys. Because, you know, I don't think I write, I know I don't write because I love words. I enjoy them. But I don't have that sense of needing to craft beautiful words. I think why I've ended up writing for screen, TV and movies is that what I like is creating feelings, to create situations on screen which give you a sense of what it feels like. Mike Nichols said something wonderful on one of those, you know, in the actor studio things. And he said the reason the motivating kind of drive behind what he does, he says he likes to examine, this is the feeling, this is what it's really like. This is what it's really like to be in love, or to be scared, or to be angry, or to be a parent, or to have sex. you know, this is what it's really like, this is the truth of that situation. And I suppose what I love about writing is being able to put up on screen that emotion, and I suppose this is why we're calling this session that. For me, the story of a movie is about taking a character through a set of feelings. That's the journey for me, and I feel more comfortable about taking an audience, and when I'm editing, is to explore 8 or 10 states of mind, I call it. I think what a movie is for a central character is 8 or 10 distinct states of mind that in that journey shape a story, you know. So it begins with insecurity, ends with, you know, confidence, or it begins, you know, or the, whoops, the other way around. Sorry, all hands. So that's what is the core of it for me, yeah.
Fantastic. But just being a bit more trying to put it down a bit technically.
Yeah.
I understand what you're saying about the conversation about the characters and so on, but when you're looking at a draft and a writer is missing points that they may well want to make without knowing it, or maybe they know and they can't get it there.
Yeah.
As a script editor, where do you go next to try and enable them to move on?
Look, every script and every relationship is different, so it's really hard to be specific about that. I think you set people different tasks, you know. I mean, sometimes I get people just to move away from the script and write about the thing in prose, because there's always so much pressure that everything you write has to be perfectly structured, and the script, the scene has to be the best scene there's ever been, you know what I mean? So I try to take that pressure off and try, you know, if it's not working, there's a reason that it's not working, and I suppose the conversation is to try and get to the bottom of what that reason is. It might mean that the writer doesn't know the character well enough, you know, they might not have, or look, any number of reasons. Look, it's really hard to, I find it hard to be particularly specific, because so much of what you do is intuitive when you're editing, and that's why I'm slightly suspicious of saying, I can give you, first meeting we have, I can give you a diagram that's the perfect structure for the movie, and what we're going to do together is, you know, work on that. It feels so much more intuitive than that. So I'm not sure I'm answering
No, I think you are answering. In fact, you're talking about the process of getting to know the writer.
Yeah.
The process of getting to know the film is about getting to know the writer.
Yes, yeah. Look, it is. And it's for them to get to know the characters. I mean, I do have questions. I mean, you know, one of the old adages of drama is that drama is conflict. But I always think there's a stage before conflict, and before you can have conflict, you have to have fear. I think that a character, the most important question I have for a character is what are they fearful of? Because their fear will generate the conflict. And so, and movies being movies, if you define what a character's greatest fear is at the beginning, it's probably a good idea to have them confront that at the other end of the movie. So that's one of my questions. You have questions, you know, you engage the writer with what they think about the character, but I think almost that one, what does a character most fear is almost the most revealing one. And then, I mean, just in terms of character, the other thing I'd like to talk to writers about is, I think what's very important, almost in the first 10 pages of the script, is to fashion the first contradiction in the character. Because, you go to the movies, and, you know, you go there to slump in front of the screen and have this stuff wash over you. And that's a fallacy, really, because the person that is working hardest in the movie experience ought to be the person in the audience, I think. And there is, I think what you have to do in a screenplay is fashion that engagement between the person in the audience. It's another conversation. The person in the conversation has in the audience has to be having a conversation with the people on screen. And so what that conversation is about, I find, and why the first contradiction is important, is I love the moment in a movie where a character says something and you in the audience says, I know that's what you're saying, and I know that you might believe that, but you're wrong. And that is your kind of portal into the subtext of a movie, because I think watching a movie is a way for you as viewer to bring all your understanding of kind of psychology and human nature and all the experiences you've had, watch that movie, and you're allow those kind of contradictions so that you can get into the subtext of the movie, so that you are constantly in this state of interpreting what everybody is doing on screen all the time. And structurally, you have to create that moment, you know, because this is why writing, and it's another thing that you do with the editing process, this is why kind of plot exposition or emotional exposition, you know, having a character absolutely tell you, you know, truthfully what they feel, isn't productive to the movie, because if it's exposition, by its essence, it's the truth. And what is interesting in your relationship with characters is the self-delusion of the character. So another reason for getting rid of exposition is that it frees you to go under the surface of the movie. And I think that's where you live in a movie. You know, you have this active engagement in, you know, everyone in the audience is more important, is more intelligent than anyone in the movie. You know, we're constantly in this process of interpreting what characters are doing in the movie. But as I say, you have to structure that portal very early on in the movie so that the characters can get into the subtext of what the story is, because that's where the enjoyment of a movie is, because you're enjoying the process of analysis of a character.
So in terms of the self-exposure of a writer, which can bring truths to those characters and then the other part of the process being the audience, do you find that with newer writers and less experienced writers, it's different from with more experienced writers? Is that about craft, or is that about an ability to be honest with themselves?
I think it's both things. I mean, my experience with younger or newer writers, I should say, and this is true for all of the arts. I think if you want to be an actor, sometimes you start by doing impersonations, you know. So, you know, in my generation, you did Jimmy Stewart or James Cagney, and that's where you start. And I know this is true for me. When you start writing, you start by doing impersonations of other scripts. And I think that's why the horror genre is such a popular genre for newer filmmakers, because everybody knows the rules and it's not so mysterious as, you know, a more kind of conventional drama piece might be. So, you know, that, yeah, there is that kind of familiarity. But I think that's part of the conversation, because in having the conversation of what is this really about, you're encouraging that kind of self-exposure. And I think, this sounds a bit pervy, but self-exposure is really important in a script, because I think it's cathartic. I think it's actually, you know, I made the joke earlier about Clubland, but Clubland is the story of a young man whose mum is a nightclub entertainer, and he is a handbag roadie, and he's totally responsible for her well-being. She's separated, and then he meets a girlfriend, and it's a clash between the mother and the girlfriend. I think that that level of self-exposure is cathartic for an audience because you're talking about the secrets that each individual member of the audience thinks are their secrets alone. And it's really, you know, and they're not, we're all the same, essentially. And there's something really cathartic about saying, you know, as I said before, this is actually what it's really like, isn't it? And sharing that kind of exposure. And that goes right across the board with editing. You're encouraging people to move towards that state of self-exposure. And, you know, even literally, you know, when you write sex scenes, which are really difficult to do, I always say, look, write them. Don't just say they fall into a puddle, tear off their clothes, and make mad passionate love. You know, that's not going to help anybody in the script. You have to just be really particular about that. Enjoy it while you're doing it. Particular about that, because then you're sort of setting the bar and saying, you know, if I can be naked about my emotions in that situation, then the rest of the cast and crew can follow. It's like, you know, I'm not hiding, so, you know, I'm sort of putting that on the table as a place to go. Does that make sense?
Absolutely. I'm wondering if I could just segue a little bit now, just because I've got my eye on the time, and I really want to leave time for the audience to ask questions. Also, I know that you've worked with Warwick Thornton and other Aboriginal writers, and I think you've also been involved in setting up some schemes to enable newer Indigenous writers. I mean, it's an area that we spend a lot of time discussing because I was here in New Zealand because a lot of our newer writers and their experienced writers in Māori. How did you become involved in working with Indigenous writers, and was there anything particular about it that strikes you as different from working with those of a European background?
Not different, really. Look, I was just asked. I was just asked to go along, and you know, it was a new experience for me. And you know, Tony, obviously, Tony Briggs is an Indigenous writer, so that was part of that journey for me. No, not different. It was interesting working with Warwick because Warwick was only ever a conversation, and I've spoken about starting the conversation at the beginning. But you know, as you go through the process, you actually work on the script, and you can provide notes for people, and you know, all of those more conventional things. With Warwick, it was only ever a conversation. He never wrote anything down. All we ever did was talk.
How did the script get written?
He would write it in longhand, and then Beck Cole, his partner, who's also a filmmaker, she would do that. She'd type it up. But it was only ever a conversation, and that was really liberating, you know, and that was great. I was a little unnerved by that at first, but then I had a report back because we were at it was an Indigenous workshop. And I heard back from the woman that was running it. She said, no, he thinks it's really working. He said, it's just like him talking to his mate Steve about how to fix a motorbike. So that was great. I mean, I'll come at it a different way. Working with Tony on the Sapphires was, I'm from Dover and he's from the Murray River, you know. They're worlds and worlds apart. But, you know, there's something common about stories. So I'm not sure I'm answering your question. I don't think
the answer might be, as you sort of said at the start,
I don't think it's different. I mean, I had my very first experience with Indigenous Australians was in Darwin when I was still teaching at the film school. And I went up there on a recruitment drive. We get sent around to the far places to, you know, say what the school is and, you know, invite people to come. And I met some guys, a project officer that was working with some Aboriginal people that were living rough in the park at Darwin, came to see me to talk about fashioning a course for them. And that actually happened. You know, it took a year or so, but we actually got around to doing it. But I went to sort of meet the guys who were living in the park and to find out what they wanted to do. And they were saying, we want, you know, we've got to tell our stories our way. And that, I was very young, it was just the first time I'd worked. But what they wanted was lots of Bruce Lee kung fu as well. So I was trying to work out, well, you guys are just affected by Hollywood, as I am. Yeah, so, look, we're all in the same. We're all in the same boat. Yeah.
I wonder, it's time of whispering miles, if there is a question from the audience.
You talked about the American dream and moving to the landscape, how that informs a lot of your cinema.
Yeah.
And you talked a little bit about your English experience. Have you got an opinion on the Australian myth and how that informs your cinema? And do you want to hazard a guess on what might be ours?
I shouldn't hazard a guess. The Australian one's an odd one because the myths of Australian kind of white society are about defeat. So Australian explorers take on the frontier, and in America they are victorious, in Australia they die. and Gallipoli, just an Anzac experience. You know, Farlap, who's a New Zealand horse, of course, he died, you know. So there's something, and one of the criticisms about Australian kind of movies always was that the central characters were kind of recessive, you know, somehow.
Isn't that the
Antipodean era? Yeah, there's something about that. So I've not figured that out yet, but I was aware of that as a kind of cultural myth. But I think we're over that. I actually think some of the success of Sapphires is that it's actually a positive story, and there isn't anything wrong with positive stories. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes. I'm forming this question in response to something you said, so it's not perfectly articulated. You talked about how buried under exposition is subtext, and subtext is what makes for beautiful stories for compelling emotion.
Yes.
And we work our way through getting rid of exposition to access that subtext. You use a phrase where you said the self-delusion of a character, which is what you want to get to. Now, in the script editing process, there is a kind of self-delusion of the writer.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
Which is part of what you are negotiating to enable the writer to get to that subtext.
Yes.
I was wondering if you could say a few more words about it, because I find that really interesting, because it works not just at the level of the story and character, but also at the level of the writer and their...
Yeah. Look, it's a difficult question. I should always take that one on notice. I think that's the process you go through with the writer, is stripping away that self-delusion, because I don't know when I'm writing why I'm writing a particular story, and I don't think they do. And so giving them those little light bulb moments when they realise that's why I'm doing it sort of clarifies that issue for them. As I say, you can't be prescriptive in that counselling relationship. I think often what you do is you say, you let them talk. And then in that counselling way, you say, well, what I hear you saying is A, B, C, D, E. Is that what you're thinking the movie is, or that's what that character interaction is? And often it's not, you know. Look, I think it's as vague as that, you know.
I'm thinking also in terms of negotiating through the character. As scripted, you can see something that character believes, says, does, whatever, that the writer can't see, then enabling the writer to see what they've actually written, or what that character is actually, where that character is actually going.
And that process is a lot about getting the writer to let go of his determination to write that character with a capital W, and letting the character live and breathe and trust, you know, that what you've written about the character is communicable to an audience, because I think writers are so insecure that you overwrite so that that point, you know, so you're absolutely clear that your point is getting across, and somehow that can be the death of the actual interest in the character. So you have to encourage the writers, like Kill Your Darlings or Let Your Babies Go, you know. I think that's one of the values you have of script editors, saying, we get it, you don't have to tell me 10 times over, we get it.
Do it alone.
Yeah, let them go, you know. Because once they, you know, because you want the script to have the voice of the characters rather than the voice of the writer, you know, and that's another thing that newer writers do, you know, that they kind of impose their voice so much on the script that the characters sort of have to fight for breath sometimes. Mm-hmm. And it's a way of saying, you know, you've done it, I trust you, you've done it, you know, let it go, let them live now.
Other questions? Yes.
So it ties into what you were just talking about.
Can you speak up a little?
Sure. This ties into the previous thing, about the first character contradiction.
Yeah.
Could you just maybe cite a couple of examples off the top of your head of where you think it's been done really well?
Only because I was watching it on cable as I was packing yesterday, that Friends with Benefits, you know, and the story is, this is the couple that believe they can have sex and they won't, you know, they'll never fall in love. So they've had sex for the first time, and then they said, that's okay, we can do that, you know. We know they can't do that, but there is a, you know, and that sets a tension between us and them. Look, Up in the Air, I think, is a beautiful film, a George Clooney film, with a totally unreliable narrator who at the beginning of the movie expounds the qualities and the success of his life, you know, and we know that is built on sand somehow, and the journey of that movie is the process of self-realisation. But, you know, it's great to just have that sense of contradiction. Maybe that's not the best word for it, but just look at that character and say, you know, you're fooling yourself, buddy. And that's the space we need to live in as an audience.
Thank you.
Another
question up there.
In your experience, have you found any inherent differences or specific challenges when you're working with the constraints of writing, say, a genre script versus trying to script edit, let's say, drama?
No, I think you should know broadly what the, you know, what the tropes of the genre are, you know. But look, different in the sense that, you know, you're working with genre, and so the sense of character is probably not so, you know, important, or other, you know, the weighting of the various components of the movie are different. But I think what you do with the genre is, you know that the writer is familiar with the genre, but that's almost an impediment, because you want this to be a different version of the genre.
Yes.
So that's the kind of discussion, is, you know, how you can tweak all of those beats in a genre piece, I think.
Questions, yes?
I think the way that you work is a delight to writers, in terms of talking on about character and relationships, and it's exactly like that's what we'd all like to do that. But quite often, when you get feedback about a script or if it doesn't work, it feels like it's to do with you haven't followed the rules of structure, or you haven't thought about the audience, which is pretty commercial. When you're working with a writer, how do you advise them to think or not think about all that stuff too much so that they don't freeze?
Look, I know it's really it's difficult, because I do development work as well with Goldhurst Pictures, who are the people that produce Sapphires and Clubman. And I must admit, you know, wearing that hat, I'm sort of less touchy-feely than I am when I'm working with writers. Look, it might be kind of altruistic, but I just think, I know exactly what you mean, you know, you get all of that commentary, and some of it feels kind of, you know, helpful. I think if you can just make the script the best it is, you have to listen to all of that stuff. You know, you have to listen to all of those comments that people give you, and you have to have that conversation with the writer. But for me, it's often, you know, when is the best time to have that conversation, you know? I'm not answering that very well, because, I mean, that is where real life comes into the process, and you have to face those kind of ground rules. I don't know. I it's not that I try to delay that, because you can't, you know, the things aren't going to get made. But
one of the things you said to me was, you talk about embracing the good and
forgetting
about the bad because it's going away.
Yes.
So maybe there's something in that area.
Look, it is. Thank you. Because a lot of those comments are about just telling you what's wrong with the script, and that's part of the script editing process. And my thing is, let's not dwell too long on what's wrong, because we're going to lose it anyway. You know, let's kind of work and embrace on what's good about the script, because that's what's going to expand and fill the piece. So I suppose, you know, in reaction to your question, I mean, what I do when you have to respond to those sorts of notes is actually embrace what is good and say, you know, push it in that direction. But look, it's a very valid question, and you know, it's something we all have to live with as kind of notes.
We have time for one more question. Yes.
With multi-character stories, would it be better to explore the theme in 8 to 10 different ways rather than explore the stakes and moments of each character in 8 to 10 different ways?
I tend to do multi-character stories, which are frustrating for exactly that reason. All I'd say about that is, in a multi-character story, they all have to have a journey, so that whenever you go from one character to the next, you hit the ground running. So that, in a way, the development of the 10 characters is almost shared organically, you know, across the movie, so that they become all become threads of the one piece. Does that make sense?
Are you talking, I mean, you need to know all of your characters equally well.
Yeah, you need to know all of them equally well, and you need to know what their emotional journey for all of them is. And they all need to be moving pretty much at the same tempo as you go from one to the other. Mm-hmm. Because the last thing, as you always want to be in the story you're in, and the danger with a multi-strand or multi-character piece is that when you go from a favourite character to a character you enjoy less, then something about the storytelling sags. So I think you always have to keep the tempo of the thing up to speed, so that you can enjoy being the character you're in at that particular moment. And for me, that means they always have to have some kind of an arrow coming out of their pocket that's moving them forward, so that as you move sideways across the thing, you're actually still moving, you know, a bit like surfing a wave, I suppose. So you're still moving forward.
I think that's probably a great place for us to close. I just want to thank you, Keith, for I think the way you talk about this craft, script editing, is actually very generous and very accurate, and that it's all about the writer and enabling the writer. And I think, you know, embracing the good is a really good watchword for all of us from the work, and the writer. So I'd like to thank you for